Hello everyone, today I am going to give a brief note on relevancy of character evidence. Character evidence plays a very important role both in civil and criminal law. The conduct and character of a man is used to determine his guilt since centuries. However, due to evolution in law and judiciary, evidentiary value and reliance on character has decreased. The general principle being, it is difficult to establish poor character. Further, judging by character would mean deviation from facts of the case to an ambiguous and subjective matter. No conviction can be based on the character of a person, as it would imply judging the past action or personal life of a person. The term character under section 55 breaks down the term into two things, which is reputation and disposition, where the former means the opinion that people in general and the latter means the habitual behavior of a particular person. Both English and Indian law does not provide an accurate definition of the term character evidence. Character evidence is only admissible in certain cases with conditions and restrictions imposed on the same. Character evidence to be produced could of the parties involved in the suit, witnesses, or even a third party associated with the proceedings. In both English law as well as Indian law, the evidence of a person's character may be offered under two circumstances. Firstly, to prove its existence as one of the facts in the case, that is, character as a fact in issue. And secondly, to prove its existence as circumstantial evidence in order to prove another fact therein. In the first case, the character of the person is the disputed fact, and it is the existence of such character which has to be proved by evidence. While in the second case, character is offered and used as evidence as the basis to infer some other facts in it, some other facts in the case. When the character of a person is the fact in issue, proof of general character may be received in both civil and criminal cases. However, when the character is not a fact in issue, but is instead used as a circumstantial evidence to prove other material issues, then it is allowed only in criminal cases and in certain circumstances, even in civil cases. Now, let us see the admissibility of character evidence in civil suits. In civil action, as a general rule, evidence of character of any person concerned is not admissible for the purpose of raising an inference as to his conduct. In other words, that a party did or did not act may not be established in civil actions by showing that his character is such as to predispose him to one course or to the other. So, the exclusion of evidence of a character of a party as a basis of inference as to his conduct is practically absolute in civil cases. In civil cases, the evidence of character is generally inadmissible unless the character is of the substance in issue. Under section 52, the expression "the character of any person concerned" is used. Therefore, it may appear to include persons who are called as witnesses, but the content of the section refers only to the parties of the proceedings. There are certain cases in which character is a fact in issue or a relevant fact. For example, in a suit for libel, if the libel consisted in attributing bad qualities to the plaintiff, and the defendant justifies the existence of these qualities, the existence of these qualities would be a fact in issue and evidence of character may be led. The character of a female chastity has been received in evidence in action for breach of promise for marriage. Best states that to admit character evidence in every case or to reject it in every case would be equally fatal to justice. That to draw a line or to define with precision where it ought to be received and where it ought to be rejected is as embarrassing a problem as any legislature can be called upon to solve. Most civil cases deals with contracts or promissory notes, etc., which are not matters that involve reckless wrongdoing or morally reprehensible conduct. In majority of cases, the subject matter is irrelevant to the character of person, so it is never accepted as evidence. Character evidence is thus accepted only in such situation where the fact shows that it is relevant. Thus, the general principle is that a party who cannot give evidence of his good character for the purpose of showing that it is improbable that he should be guilty of the conduct imputed to him. For example, if a person is charged with negligent driving, he cannot give evidence of fact of his character and conduct has been such that he could not have been guilty of negligence. Similarly, his opposite party cannot give evidence of the fact that his character and conduct had been so bad that he must have been negligent. The reason is that court has to try the case on the basis of its facts for the purpose of determining whether the defendant should be liable or not. The court has not to try the character of the parties. Thus, it may be laid down as a general rule that in civil action, evidence of character of any person is not admissible for the purpose of raising an inference as to its conduct. In criminal inquiries, the relevancy of character evidence is different from civil cases. In criminal proceedings, the fact that the person accused is of a good character is relevant. In criminal cases, the accused is allowed to prove his good character either in cross-examination or examination in chief. But so far as concerns proof of the accused good character by another witness, what must be deposed to is not particular good acts by him, but his general reputation in the community. Strictly, the witness' own opinion of his character is irrelevant. But in particular, considerable latitude is allowed and a witness is often asked to say what he knows of the accused character. The evidence of character is primarily relevant as to credibility, that is, it makes his testimony more worthy of belief. Good character in criminal cases, even though it is admissible, but it is a weak evidence. However, in certain cases, good character may become favorable evidence in favor of an accused in doubtful cases and where the prosecution fails to prove the guilt of the accused beyond reasonable doubts. Good character presumably includes good reputation, which a man may be in his own circle, as well as his real disposition as distinct from what his friends and neighbors may think of him. The principle upon which good character may be proved is that it affords a presumption against the commission of crime. This presumption arises from the improbability. However, character evidence is a very weak form of evidence. According to Section 53A, evidence of a character of previous sexual experience not relevant in certain cases. This section has been brought in by the amendment of 2013, where the growing crimes of rape necessitated some changes in the Indian Penal Code and Criminal Procedure Code and Indian Evidence Act. This section is one such method of protecting the victim of rape. This section applies to the prosecution of sexual offences. This section 53A applies even to attempt and to commit such offences. This section declares the evidences are irrelevant of the character of the victim of rape or her previous sexual experience with any person, then declares that evidence of her character or her previous sexual experience with any person is irrelevant on the quality of issue of such consent. Now, let us see what Section 54 says. Bar on the proof of previous bad character in criminal proceedings. The general evidence of good character of the accused is always relevant. This is not so with regard to general evidence of bad character. In criminal proceeding, the fact that the accused person has a bad character is irrelevant and cannot be proved. The reason is that the prosecution must prove the guilt of the accused with necessary evidence in support of the charge. But the prosecution cannot take the help of bad character of the accused in order to establish its case. If the prosecution is allowed to prove bad character of the accused, then that would prejudice the mind of the court. It makes the court biased against the accused. If evidence of bad character of the accused is permitted to be proved, the court may come to the conclusion that he has committed the offense in question. Therefore, this would prejudice the fair trial to which the accused is entitled. However, there are three exceptions to the rule of the irrelevance of bad character in criminal cases. The first exception is that the previous bad character is relevant in reply if the evidence has been given that he has good character. In Indian system of law, an accused starts with the presumption of innocence. His bad character is not relevant unless he gives evidence of good character, in which case, by way of rebuttal, evidence of bad character may be adduced. The second exception is that the evidence of bad character can be proved in case in which the bad character is in issue. And the third exception is that a previous conviction is not admissible in evidence against the accused except where he is liable to enhanced punishment under Section 75 of the IPC on account of previous conviction, or unless evidence of good character be given, in which case the fact that the accused had previously been convicted of an offense is admissible as evidence of bad character. According to Section 55, the character evidence provided in civil cases is such that it can affect the amount of damages that are to be received is relevant and admissible in the court of law. This section limits the definition of character evidence to reputation and disposition. However, evidence provided under Section 54 may have general reputation and general disposition. Reputation entails what is thought of a person by other or general opinion of others, whereas disposition entails texture of the mind. In civil cases, good character may not be proved in aggravation of damages. However, bad character is admissible in mitigation of damages, provided that it is justifiable. Thank you, everyone.